Hi there. We're here in the Arkle Bee Yard, one of our Honeybee Research Center's outyards. And we're here today with Les Eccles from the Ontario Beekeepers Association. Les is the lead for their Tech Transfer program. Les started working with us quite a few years ago. What year was that, Les?
2005, I believe.
2005, yeah. Right. Yeah. So he worked with us for 5 years, did some consulting work with beekeepers in Mexico, and for the last 10 years, he's been the lead for the Tech Transfer Program of the Ontario Beekeepers Association. So we work really closely with that Tech Transfer Program, and they were very involved with this LVG breeding project. So this is our concluding video and the LVG series, and Les is going to explain to us how the Tech Transfer Program will be implementing this breeding system within the beekeeping community. So Les, could you tell us a little bit about what the Tech Transfer Program does and about the Tech Transfer Breeding Program?
Sure. Yep. So yeah, we're pretty fortunate in the province to have a program like the Tech Transfer Program. It's been going since the early 90s when Varroa mites actually first came in, and which is kind of pertinent. We're talking about low Varroa growth and how far we've came since Varroa first came into the province in the early 90s. But the mandate of the program is research and education. So we do a lot of projects on all kinds of best management practices in beekeeping and training and workshops. But a big part of the program is the Ontario Resistant Honeybee Selection Programs, or ORBS. So we work with beekeepers to select for resistance to pests and diseases, which is why we're part of this project for the low Varroa growth.
Maybe you could talk a little bit about how you would train beekeepers to implement this program. What the basic steps are in breeding for low Varroa growth?
Yeah, well, the kind of the advantage to selecting for low Varroa growth is it's actually quite simple. The reasons why the colonies may be resistant to mites might be a little bit complicated, but to select for low Varroa growth is just a matter of monitoring, which we should be doing anyways, and looking at mite growth, or so mite populations in the spring, and then as they grow through the season and their end population in the fall. And just, you're basically selecting for colonies that produce fewer mites in those colonies. That's kind of the simple way. So you can monitor using sticky boards, alcohol wash. Those are probably the most reliant ways of monitoring. But it's something you're probably already doing, and you can just use those numbers in a way to select for low Varroa growth.
So there have been a number of breeding projects started that are more survival kind of projects where beekeepers just let the mites run their course. Maybe you could talk a bit about what an advantage of this system is relative to that survival breeding.
Yeah, well, I think, you know, we've came a long way now understanding Varroa mites and how to manage them. And, you know, Varroa mites are animal health, animal welfare situation. So just letting Varroa mites run through a colony, that colony really suffers and eventually dies. It creates a biosecurity issue, neighboring beekeepers. And the fact is, we have other options now. We don't need to let Varroa just run its course and kind of mutilate a colony. That's why we're working on projects like these, because now we know specific characteristics and methods to select for Varroa resistance without the bees having to suffer.
Right. So at the end of your selection process, where you look at that mite growth, we're then able to treat all the colonies.
Absolutely.
And try to keep as many as possible alive.
Yes.
Through that. So yeah, it's very good from an ethical standpoint, from a biosecurity standpoint, and certainly having live hives to bees to work with. None of us can keep bees with without live bees.
Yeah.
Let's talk a bit about some of the limitations of the program in terms of scale of beekeepers, who can get involved, at what level people need to be at to be able to do this kind of work.
Yeah, it's always a challenge when beekeepers, they take a lot of interest in bee breeding, but often if they're starting, it's very small scale, But the reality is, to really select for a characteristic, no matter what it is, you need a very large number of colonies to actually make a selection and make an advancement in breeding. So scale is a big one. You know, you really should have at least 100, a couple hundred colonies before you really enter a breeding program to have something to work with. That's one of the main limitations,
right,
to entering a breeding program.
But on a small scale, perhaps an association could pool colonies and select when they're with a bit of guidance and some expertise with some members. That would be another option. Any thoughts about that, Les?
Yeah, and absolutely, and that's what we want to encourage through the OBA Tech Transfer Program and our breeding program. We have resources in place. We have workshops to train beekeepers who want to get into breeding. And that group, that association, they meet, they work together, they discuss and prioritize how breeding and selection is going to work. And so we're always communicating. And so we understand each other, what it means to breed and what we're talking about. So we have that in Ontario. The Tech Transfer Program goes to local beekeepers associations to present that information, to coordinate that within the province.
Right, so provide that support. Yeah. And in other jurisdictions, there are Tech Transfer Programs that may be interested in helping beekeepers with this fairly straightforward breeding method. Let's talk a bit about some of the beekeeping management that's involved when we're doing this, because for one, if we have to have the same queen at the beginning and the end of our testing, so if a colony swarms in the middle, that'll artificially drop the numbers down. If we split a colony after we do the first count, that'll drop it down. And there's other things that we need to consider with our management. Could you elaborate a bit more on that?
And that's always a challenge in a breeding program. When you're selecting and comparing colonies, you really want, again, a large number, but they're all managed the same way. So if you split a colony, you have to split everything and split them equally. In regards to varroa growth, that has a real impact on how varroa grows in a colony. So it's very hard to compare a colony that's been split and not split to look at those numbers. But that's relative to all characteristics you're really looking at in a breeding program. They really need to be managed the same way. In regards to queens, like marking queens, we think of that maybe as a luxury, having a marked queen in a colony. But like you mentioned, swarming, supersedure, you need to have marked queens to know whether that's happened. Supersedure can happen like that and you don't notice.
Right, especially in the middle of the summer, yeah, when we're not looking. Yeah, that happens very frequently and we're not even aware of it. Good points. Backing up to what you said a moment ago, you're talking about other things that beekeepers are selecting for. One of my concerns with selecting for only one trait, like low varroa growth rate, is that we might lose track of some of the other positive characteristics we're looking at. How would you recommend bee breeders implement this without losing what the other characteristics they're working for?
Yeah, breeding's a real challenge, and having multiple characteristics and evaluating them, it takes a bit of science. Most breeders start with a pre-selection going in, so they've, if low defensive behavior is important, which is generally an important one, and perhaps low swarming, you'd want to pre-select. So before you even select for low varroa growth, you'd already selected for that and bring that in, and that's what you're going to select for low varroa growth in. You kind of have to want a pre-selection before those enter into your breeding program. Kind of on the more the next level, though, within the ORBS program, we have a selection. It's an Excel sheet, but it's a way of doing the evaluation calculations to put in multiple characteristics so that you're not losing and
right,
you're not overseeing some of these other things that are important in beekeeping.
Right. Oh, good records are,
yeah,
it comes down to the basics with any breeding program. You really have to good records of everything. So when we do our Buckfast breeding program, it's kind of a longer term process, and we use a 3-year cycle where we raise queens 1 year, we introduce them to collies, and let their genetics take over that hive The following year we do our testing, and then we're able to graft from the breeders picked in the second year. So it's a 3-year cycle. We compress that cycle for this project for research purposes, but personally I think that would be the best approach for beekeepers to take. What were your thoughts on that, Les?
Yeah, and it kind of comes back to that challenge of scale in a breeding program, I think, too. You talk about you need to have a queen for 2 to 3 years, and so you need to start with a large number, because inevitably, swarming, supersedure, you're going to lose those numbers. Mm-hmm. So what you have in the end for that second, third year, where you're actually going to, we call those proven queens, where we've proved them over a number of years, and we know, okay, we are going to breed, or we're going to rear queens from that one.
Yeah.
And that's a real long-term strategy.
Right.
So that's, you know, having a scale to be able to go that long and then continue doing that over time. I think the exciting thing about this low Varroa growth is that we're successful in selecting for low Varroa growth in that short time.
Yeah.
And that nature of the research. But it's important to remember, you can't just select for that once and then stop. You need to continue to select whatever you're breeding. You're looking at those dollars, you got another whatever number of colonies, and you're doing it again. An example in our breeding program, the ORS program, we have breeders that have been breeding for 20 years. They don't start breeding, get what they want, and quit. Breeders breed for the long term over and over again.
Yeah, if you're not constantly trying to improve, things are constantly going the other direction.
Yeah.
So it is a constant thing, and it's long term, but this is something that's important enough that we're working for even the future generations of beekeepers with this. It will be a long term goal. We're hoping that as many people as possible can be doing this kind of work. If we spread it out and more is done in other jurisdictions throughout the world, over time, we'll be making improvements, and we'll be able to share some of those gains that we've made. So, Les, your tech transfer program provides a great support for the local breeders. Can you touch on the importance of beekeepers supporting those local breeders?
Yeah, well, I think if nothing else from this talk, you see a lot of effort goes into a breeding program. Breeders have a lot invested in what they're producing, a really high quality queen to produce high quality colonies. So, you know, buying local stock and putting good value on that, I think supports the industry a lot, you know. And if you're interested in getting involved in breeders, you know, get involved with your local associations. The ORBS program, the tech transfer program has workshops to provide training. If you're watching this, you're not from our area, you know, look for your local breeders and ask them, you know, what they're doing, and show interest and put value in all the effort that they're putting into raising local queens.
Many people take queen rearing courses, and then when they go home, they're very happy to pay $50 because they see how much effort goes into that.
Absolutely.
So thanks very much for watching this series of 3 videos. Keep your bees healthy, and we'll see you next time.